Welcome to today's power class. Myself, K. Manjula, Assistant Professor of Physics, Dr. BRR Government Degree College, Jatchalra, Mahabub Nagar District. Today, in this class, let us discuss about these contents. Already, we are discussing these aberrations chapter. In this aberrations chapter, we have already completed the yesterday's class, that is aberrations, that is chromatic aberration and elimination methods. Similarly, in this today's class, let us learn about the monochromatic aberrations, the aberrations which depends upon the optical system. So, monochromatic aberrations are 5 in 10. Let us know first the main aberration, that is spherical aberration. So, that is spherical aberration definition. And spherical aberration in case of plane refracting surface. So, this one, spherical aberration in case of plane refracting surface, and similarly spherical aberration in case of thin lens, and removal methods of spherical aberration. These we are going to discuss. Let us try to understand what is spherical aberration. See here, you are observing this slide here. This is an optical system. This is the lens. This is the lens. And this is the principal axis of the lens system, and this is the optical axis. So these are always perpendicular to each other. So this is the point object here at O. The object is placed at point O. Then what happens is the rays which are coming from this point object incident on this lens system like this. But after getting refracted, they do not meet at one single point on the other side of the lens system. That means the rays do not converge at a single point. That means we can't get a clear image because different rays meet at different points. Because we already know that the deviation here, the D is equal to H by F. The deviation depends upon the height of the light rays. So the rays, the deviation is less for the paraxial rays, whereas these are the paraxial rays. So these two rays are paraxial rays. Similarly, the outer rays, the rays are known as the marginal rays. The rays which for this marginal rays, the deviation is more, so that the marginal rays gets more deviated than the paraxial rays. So the paraxial rays produced image here. See here, the paraxial rays, these are the paraxial rays produced image away from the lens, which is at a distance fp. So this is the focal length of the paraxial rays. So this here we get a image, so that one image, that is the image due to the paraxial rays. Similarly, the for marginal rays, the marginal rays produce the image nearer to, because they get more deviated than the paraxial rays. So marginal rays produce the image nearer to the lens here. This is nearer to the lens, and at a distance of fm, the image due to marginal rays, that is fm. Fm is nothing but a marginal focal length. This is the paraxial focal length. So by this we can understand that the rays which are incidenting on the lens system, after refracted, they do not meet at one single point. So we can't get the clear single image of the object. So that means, and all the other rays that is remaining of means all other paraxial rays, all other marginal rays focus at different points between this FM and FP. See here, this is the FM and FP, different rays are meet between in these two. So thus the image is not clear at any point in the principal axis. So that means this defect, the image is spread between these two points, that is marginal focal length point and the paraxial focal length point. So this type of aberration formed in this lens system is known as the spherical aberration. So totally the definition for this spherical aberration is nothing but the inability of a lens to produce a point image of a object on the axis is known as a spherical aberration. This spherical aberration is related to principal axis only. It is not off from the principal axis. So this is about the spherical aberration. Let us see what happens if we move a screen from in between this marginal focal length and the paraxial focal length. See here, if a screen is placed perpendicular to the axis and passing through the paraxial ray focus FP, so here FP, a circular, we get a circular patch of light like this, circular patch of light whose central region is brighter, this one central region is bright compared to its outer region. So similarly, the screen is placed perpendicular to the axis and passing through the marginal ray focus, here marginal ray focus, here also we get a circular patch of light, but the outer edge is brighter than the central edge. This is just opposite to the before one. So this is the condition when we place a screen at marginal focal length and paraxial focal length. Similarly, if the screen is moved between FM and FP like this, FM and FP, the size of circular patch of light is minimum diameter at this point. You are observing this one AB, no? This is known as a circle of least confusion. So this is we consider as a clear object of this, clear image of the object. So the diameter of this patch of light at here AB, the diameter, suppose if we consider this one principle of least circle of least confusion, the diameter, this one, the diameter, so actually this will be like the diameter of AB is the AB is called the circle of least confusion. This is the possible image formed between FM and FP. Similarly, there are two types of we can understand, that is two types of spherical aberrations, that is longitudinal spherical aberration and lateral spherical aberration. By seeing this figure, the distance between, as in the case of chromatic aberration, the distance, this is the marginal focal length, this is the paraxial focal length, so the distance between these two points is known as the longitudinal spherical aberration, whereas the radius, this is the circle of least confusion, the radius of this circle measures the lateral spherical aberration. These are the, one is lateral, another is longitudinal. Let us calculate the spherical aberration produced by, means calculation later we'll see. Next, let us see the spherical aberration produced by the concave lens. Already we know that in the case of chromatic aberration also, the aberration is taken to be a negative. In this case also, the spherical aberration produced by a concave lens is taken to be negative, because here just it is opposite to the formation of image is opposite to the convex lens. So that's what the aberration is taken to be as a negative for this one, and for convex lens it is taken to be as a positive. Similarly, let us calculate the same longitudinal spherical aberration produced by a plane refracting surface. Here, plane refracting surface will be there, and curved surface also there. Just in this, in our syllabus, plane refracting surface. For this purpose, consider a plane refracting surface. That is this one. AB is the plane refracting surface. See here, this is AB is the plane refracting surface, and this plane refracting surface is dividing the two medium. This is mu 1 and this is mu 2. The refractive indexes of two media on both sides of this plane refracting surface is mu 1 and mu 2, and also assume mu 2 is greater than mu 1. So next, let us our object P is our object. P is an object point on the x axis, because spherical aberration is in the case of spherical aberration, object should be placed on the principal axis only. So for that purpose, P is an object point on the x axis of a distance. Here see, distance can be taken as a minus x naught, because we are moving left side towards the left side from the refracting surface. So that is the distance of the object is minus x naught from the origin. Say this is the origin. If we assume this origin, this can be automatically minus x naught. Okay, that is about the object and object distance. And let us assume PQ is the incident ray. So PQ is the incident ray, which is incident on the refracting surface at height h, and I, here I is also what? Angle of incidence. These are the preliminary things from this figure what we observed. That is, similarly QR, so the ray is incidenting like this, and after that it refracted in this direction, that is QR. So this is the QR. This is the QR ray, this is the refracted ray, this is the incident ray. See, the refracted ray, if we extend this refracted ray, the refracted ray is, this refracted ray appears to emerge from the point P1. A new place, that is P1 on the x-axis. That means P1 is the image of the point object P. This is the formation of image due to the plane refracting surface. So what is the distance? Similarly, say this is a minus x1, whereas the object distance is minus x0. Here this is the minus x1. So let us calculate the longitudinal spherical aberration. Let us consider the Snell's law for the refraction process. That is, what is Snell's law here? That is mu 1 sin I is equal to mu 2 sin R. Here R is the refraction angle. Here in this figure you are observing, this is the R. R is the angle of refraction. And if we take a triangle, that is P1QO. If we take this triangle, just write down the value of tan R. Tan R is nothing but H by minus X1. If this is R, this is also R. See here. If this is R, this is also R. So tan R is equal to minus H by x1. Similarly, tan R is nothing but sin R by cos r is equal to minus h by x1. By this, x1 can be, because we are writing the object, that is image distance, x1 can be written as x1 is equal to h minus h cos r by sin r. Just we are expanding the terms. See how minus h. What is the value of this cos r can be written as under root of 1 minus sin square r by sin r. Next step, x1 is equal to, here if we substitute here, see here, if we substitute this sin Snell's law again, sin I by sin r is nothing but mu 2 by Snell's law, that is sin I by sin r is equal to mu 2 by mu 1, that must be equal to mu. Therefore, sin r can be written as sin I by mu. Substituting this sin r in this equation, we get x1 is equal to minus mu h by sin I square root 1 minus sin square I by mu square. So, this is, say this is first equation. Similarly, from figure, again sin I, from figure, sin I is equal to, sin I can be written as opposite side by diagonal, h by, this is h, say this is h, and this can be written as h square plus x naught square root, like this, sin I is equal to h by h square plus x naught square. Say this is second equation. So, substituting this sin I value in the first equation, we get x1 is equal to minus mu h by h under root h square plus x naught square by h square root 1 minus h square by mu square into h square plus x naught square. Next step, x1 is equal to, if you take this x naught square as a common, by taking x naught square as a common, that is minus mu x naught 1 plus h square by x naught square to the power of into 1 minus h square by mu square x naught square into 1 plus h square by x naught square to the power of. Next step, continuation of the steps, x1 is equal to minus mu x naught into 1 plus h square by x naught square to the power of, again 1 minus h square by mu square x naught square into 1 plus h square by x naught square to the power minus 1 to the power of, again next step, minus mu x naught 1 plus h square by 2 x naught square into 1 minus h square by mu square x naught square. This we use by using binomial expansion, 1 minus 1 plus x to the power minus 1 is equal to 1 minus x, means by omitting the higher order terms, we get this term 1 minus h square by x naught square to the power of, again using this binomial expansion, minus mu x naught into 1 plus h square by 2 x naught square, 1 minus h square by mu square x naught square, means just we are neglecting higher order terms, that is h to the power 4 term. Next step, this one, this mu minus mu x naught 1 plus h square by 2 x naught square minus h square by 2 mu square x naught square minus mu x naught 1 plus h square by 2x naught square by taking as a common 1 minus 1 by mu square, the remaining. Next, minus mu x naught minus, on simplifying, minus h square mu by 2x naught 1 minus 1 by mu square. Here one assumption for paraxial rays. We are talking about the spherical aberration is relates to the different deviations for different rays. That is, means out of these rays we are considering the paraxial rays and the marginal rays. For paraxial rays, the limiting case h as h tends to 0. That is, height should be very very less from the principal axis. So, by substituting this case in the third equation, this equation reduces to, that is by omitting this star, that is x1 can be written as minus mu x0. By this third and fourth equation, we can understand that spherical aberration is nothing but minus h square mu by 2x0 into 1 minus 1 by mu square. Here, what is the meaning of this minus sign? Negative minus sign. Minus sign shows that non-paraxial rays means marginal rays. Non-paraxial rays appear to diverge from a point which is still farther away from the paraxial image point. So, that is the that is the meaning of this equation. So that's what we get, two types of, that is two paraxial focal length and marginal focal length. In between these two points, different focal lengths of the images are formed. This is about a measurement of spherical aberration due to plane refracting surface. Similarly, we calculate this spherical aberration in case of thin lens also, but it is this is a thin lens. Here you are observing, this is the thin lens. Here the spherical aberration produced by a thin lens will be minimum when the angle of deviation is minimum. So that is the main here, that is, this would occur when deviation at each of the refracting surfaces are equal to, get this. So this aberration depends upon the form, that is shape factor, that is for this convex lens, this is this one, this is shape factor. Suppose say this is the R1 is the radius of curvature of first surface, R2, this shape on the shape factor can be written as or defined as R2 plus R1 by R2 minus R1. So this is the equation, that is shape factor of spherical aberration for thin lens. Let us, after understanding the spherical aberration, let us discuss about minimizing spherical aberrations. After understanding, we have to minimize. We can't eliminate, totally 100% not eliminate this problem, but we can minimize. So there are so many methods to minimize this spherical aberration. This is first one is by the use of stops. Next, by the use of two suitable lenses in contact. Next, by the use of crossed lens. Next, by the use of plano convex lens. Next, by the use of two convex lenses separated by a distance. These are the methods to eliminate the spherical aberration. Let us discuss one by one, that is by the use of stops. See here. What is the reason for this spherical aberration? That is marginal rays and a paraxial rays. The main reason for spherical aberrations is different zones. Suppose say this is lanes, if this is the lanes, different zones, first zone, second zone, like this. This different zones. This. Yes, different zones of lens have different focal lengths. That one. Next, the spreading of image takes place along the principal axis only. That is, if it is FM and FP. This is the principal axis. The image spreading on the principal axis in between these two points. Similarly, the paraxial rays produces image at one point and marginal rays produces image at another point. They do not converge to a single point. So, this is we have to make only one converge point. So, if we avoid the paraxial rays, we get single image due to the marginal rays. If we avoid the marginal rays, we get the paraxial image. So this by using these stocks, but this method is not generally used because intensity of the object decreases. So this is the, so see here, this one, the stock is nothing but a, see here, this is the stock. Here if I place a stock here, this, that is slits, stock is nothing but a slit. Only the, here see, only the paraxial rays are allowing to pass through this lens system. So we get a only the paraxial image, that is IM, like this. Means because marginal rays are not allowed to pass through this lens system. Similarly, if we place a stop like this, only the marginal rays are allowed to pass, paraxial rays are stopped by this stop. So this is the use of stop, but this method is not generally used because the intensity of the object decreases. The intensity of the images, because some rays are here not passing through the lens, automatically the intensity decreases. Next, another method also there, that is, you are familiar with this one. Two suitable lenses in contact. Two suitable lenses in contact means one is convex lens and another is concave lens. We know that the spherical aberration in case of convex lens is positive and in case of concave lens is negative. So if we combine these two types of lenses, the image of marginal rays coincide with the image of paraxial rays. So but this combination works only for that particular pair of object and image only. Different objects and image pairs need different types of combinations. So this is the one method. Next, another method also, by using another method also, we can decrease this spherical aberration. That is crossed lens. Crossed lens you are observing in this slide, that is if the ratio of this radius of curvature is 1:6, that is R1 by R2 is equal to 1:6, that is this type of lens is known as a crossed lens. So that is, here see here, this FM and FP are just coinciding, so there it is. It means it is used to minimize this spherical aberration. So that is next another method also there, that is by the use of plano convex lens. That is plano by use of plano. Out of this in this plano convex lens, say this is plano convex lens, this convex side must be facing the incident beams of rays, then this aberration may be eliminated means can be minimized, that is by using of plano convex lens. Because here see here, these are the four different ways we can use it in our lens system. See here, this is the when a parallel, first one, these four figures you are observing, coming to the first figure, when a parallel with parallel rays of light incidenting on the plane surface, there is no deviation at the first surface. See here, at the plane surface, see here, this is the plane surface. At plane surface, there is no deviation. But the total deviation is at the convex surface only, on the second side only. So, the equal distribution of, here there is no equal distribution of deviation. So, that is, only the deviation is occurring at the second surface only. Similarly, in figure B, also deviation, whole deviation is at convex surface only, not at the plane surface. So, in these two cases, there is no equal distribution of deviation. In this, the deviation is equally distributed. Next, totally plano-convex lens by facing convex side to the incident rays, we can minimize the spherical aberration. The same method, that is by the use of two convex, plano-convex lenses, separated by a distance. This is the method. Let us calculate the what is the distance. By using a plano-convex lens, we can eliminate the spherical aberration. Let us see how we reduce this, eliminate this spherical aberration. See here, these are the two plano-convex lenses of same material. This is the principal axis of these two lens system. The distance between these two lenses, say that is D. The focal length of first lens, say that is F1. Focal length of second lens, say that is F2. Okay. Next, let us see how the image formation is occurring in this one. For this, see here. This is the diagram you are observing. This is in this slide you are observing this diagram. See here. See. What is it? We have to just calculate the at what distance we have to place these two plano-convex lenses to minimize the spherical aberration. So for the purpose, let us consider two convex lenses of focal length F1 and F2. See here, that is F1 and F2. And separated by a distance, say this is distance is D. Here the deviation, see the deviation at first lens, that is delta 1. The deviation at second lens, say that is delta 2. So total deviation can be written as delta is equal to delta 1 plus delta 2. So, how this angle of deviation are occurring, just to discuss. Let a ray of light PA, say this is the ray of light PA, is parallel to the axis incident on the first lens at a height, say this is height H1. And after that, it undergoes a refraction along AB. See, this is AB. Suffers a deviation through an angle delta 1. This is the deviation. See here. This is the deviation. So delta 1. Okay. This is incident ray and this is the refracted ray. So delta 1 can be written as, that is delta 1 is equal to, if we H1 by F1, because already we know the deviation is the ratio of H and F. Again, the ray, suppose in the absence of this second lens, the refracted ray AB touches the principal axis and forms the image at point F in the absence of second lens. The refracted ray AB, but in the presence of second lens, the refracted ray AB strikes the second lens at a height H2. Here you are observing, this is the height H2. And suffers again deviation, second deviation delta 2, through an angle, that is delta 2. What is delta 2 here? Again, we can write this delta 2 is equal to H2 by F2. By this figure, you can understand this one, delta 2. Delta, this is the deviation at the second lens, that is delta 2. So, the delta 2 can be written as H2 by F2. Here, total, that is total resultant image of resultant focal length, that is the emergent ray produces the image at C, focal point of the combination. Due to this combination, C is the resultant focal length. So, for a minimum spherical aberration, the deviation should be equally distributed. That means delta 1 should be delta 2. This is the condition. So, that is delta 1 is equal to delta 2. According to our experimental one, that is delta 1 can be written as H1 by F1, and delta 2 can be written as H2 by F2. Therefore, H1 by F1 must be equal to H2 by F2. So, this is. Therefore, the ratio between the heights, that is H1 by H2 at first lens and at a second lens, that is H1 by H2 can be written as F1 by F2. Next, let us think about, just take two similar triangles from this figure. So, that is AC1, F1. So, the AC1, F1 and BC2, F1. See, AC1, F1. This one, AC1, F1 and BC2, F2. These are the two similar triangles. By these two similar triangles, we can write the ratios of H1 by F1. H1 by F1 can be written as H2 by F1 minus FD. So, here see, this is D. This is D. Okay. Next, this is the focal length, F1. So, automatically the distance becomes F1 minus D. So, substituting this in this equation, H1 by F1 is equal to H2 by F2. F2 is nothing but F1 minus D. So, by these two equations, H1 by H2 is equal to, that means this by this equation and this equation, we can write H1 by H2 is equal to F1 by F2. Again, this F1 by F2 must be equal to F1 by F1 minus D. So, finally, the distance can be get the distance as we can get as D is equal to F1 minus F2. That means, what is the meaning of this equation? D is equal to F1 minus F2 means the spherical aberration of a combination of two thin lenses is minimum when their separation is equal to the difference of their focal lengths. So, this is the meaning. Suppose that D should be equal to the difference of their focal lengths, that is F1 minus F2. So, this is about how to eliminate spherical aberration due to plano convex lenses with some distance. See here, just we take this lens system like this, and we calculated the deviations, delta 1 how much and delta 2 how much. For minimum deviation, that is delta 1 should be delta 2. By this we get H1 by H2 is equal to F1 by F2. Again, after considering the two similar triangles, we get H1 by F1 is equal to H2 by F1 minus T. If we calculate, we get distance of these two lens system is equal to F1 minus F2. So this is the spherical aberration elimination method. So in this class, what we have learnt, just recall them. That is, in this class, we have discussed about the monochromatic aberrations. What are monochromatic aberrations? In place of white light, if we use a monochromatic light, depending upon the optical system, aberrations also arise. Those are monochromatic aberrations. Those are in five types. That is, spherical aberration, astigmatism, coma, distortion and curvature. Coming to the spherical aberrations, the spherical aberration arises due to the marginal rays and paraxial rays. Paraxial rays at paraxial rays converge at one point and the marginal rays converge at one point after getting refracted from the lens system. So due to this reason, we get a paraxial focal length image, paraxial focal length and marginal focal length. In between these two, different points of images are formed. That means the image of the point object on the principal axis is spreading, looks like a spreading. So this type of aberration is known as a spherical aberration. So the inability means how we define this spherical aberration. The inability of a lens to produce a point image of a point object on the principal axis is known as a spherical aberration. Remember, this spherical aberration is relates to the object which is placed on the principal axis, not off the axis. So that in that case, another defects will be formed. That later we'll discuss. So in between these two points, if we place a screen, we get a circle of least confusion. This may be considered as this AB. This AB is considered as a most possible image. So this is the image due to spherical aberration. And this spherical aberration can be longitudinal spherical aberration and lateral spherical aberration. Longitudinal is nothing but the difference between FP minus F is the longitudinal spherical aberration, whereas the radius here, if this is a circle of least confusion, the radius of this least confusion circle is known as a lateral or transverse spherical aberration. Similarly, spherical aberration produced by this concave lens is taken to be negative. We have calculated the longitudinal spherical aberration due to plane refracting surface. That comes as, that is, spherical aberration, that is minus h square mu by 2 x naught into 1 minus 1 by mu square. Here by seeing this equation, negative sign shows that non-paraxial rays appear to diverge from a point which is still further away from the paraxial image point. Similarly, in case of thin lens also, we can write the spherical aberration. This spherical aberration in case of thin lens depends upon the shape factor. That is, shape factor is nothing but R1 plus R2 by R2 minus R1. That is, similarly, after understanding the spherical aberration, next let us discuss about the minimization of this spherical aberration by using of stops, by suitable lenses contact, by use of crossed lens, plano-convex lens, and by the use of two convex lenses separated by some distance. And another one is, by using a aplanatic lens. Tomorrow we'll discuss this aplanatic lens. Next, let us see by the use of stops. If you use the stops like this, see here, this is stops like this, only either of the marginal rays or paraxial rays are incident on the lens system, so we get only single converging point, so that we get a single clear single image. But this method is not followed because the intensity of the image decreases. Next, by using the two suitable lenses in contact, by combining this convex lens and concave lens, we can minimize the spherical aberration. Crossed lens also. Crossed lens is nothing but the ratio of these, it is of curvatures of a lens, R1 by R2 is equal to -1/6. That is known as a crossed lens. And plano convex lens also. If the convex surface placed towards the incident rays, then the minimization of we can minimize the spherical aberration. Similarly, that is the when two convex lenses are separated by distance, how much distance we have to keep them to eliminate. So the distance must be equal to the difference of their focal lengths. That is, this is d is equal to f1 minus f2. So this is the elimination methods for spherical aberration. Okay, time is up.